Our goal at CARCS is first to get the word out in our community, which includes not just Rehoboth, but the towns, our surrounding towns of Attleboro, Seacon, Dighton, Rumford, and Nantucket, Rhode Island. So it's a tough task to cover those that many communities all at once. So first, we're trying to get the word out. Second, we're trying to inform as many people as we can about what's going on. The issues concerning Spectra's Access Northeast Pipeline project are complex. It's a colossal project affecting communities from New York to Maine and into Canada. As Spectra Energy is due to begin the filing process with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission in November of this year, we will all need to be educated and active if we hope to stop this facility from getting built. There are many reasons not to want this compressor station in our town: falling property values, long-term economic concerns, noise, light, and air pollution, environmental concerns, including threats to our water quality and our water resources, fear of explosions and accidents, and negative health impacts. Tonight, we're going to talk about that. Dr. Nordgaard has very graciously come to speak to us and to help inform us on this topic. It's not just a compressor station as far as our town goes. It's also pipelines and where the pipelines bisect our properties. We don't have very much mapping information right now, but that will be coming out as soon as we can organize ourselves and find the proper mapping systems. But pipeline explosions are as common or more so than even compressor station explosions. And the same kinds of impact zones that you saw on maps up front also apply to pipelines as well. So I'll let Dr. Nordgaard take it from here, but please join me in warmly welcoming him to the stage.
So I'd like to start by also thanking you all for coming out here on a weeknight to hear me speak. It's a real honor for me to come here as somebody I live outside of Boston, and I really appreciate being invited to come speak to your community. I'm a pediatrician. I'm originally from Minnesota. I moved to Boston for my training in pediatrics. And after I completed that, for the past year, I've been working as a pediatrician in Dorchester at a community health center. But I've also been spending, for more than the past year now, investigating compressor stations. I also have before I trained in medicine, I worked in research. And I'm an author of a number of research papers in cell biology, ophthalmology, clinical medicine. But I would like to point out that I don't have formal public health training. What I do have is my training as a clinician, as a pediatrician, and as a scientist. So what we'll do is talk about all of the things that I've been learning in the past year about compressor stations and some things that are unique to Rehoboth. And I'd like to start off with a quote: "There are known knowns, and there are unknown, or there are known unknowns, and unknown unknowns." And this is a theme that I hope to bring up throughout the talk. Not that I'm a huge fan of Rumsfeld, but the quote is, I think, appropriate for us to talk about compressor stations. And that's because there are some things that we clearly do know about compressor stations. There are other things we'll talk about tonight that we have some idea about compressor stations, and then there's a lot that I think we don't know, and I keep learning more and more myself, and some of the things I've learned I had no idea even a month ago. So I'll try to bring up this idea again. But these are just a few things that we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about what is a compressor station, and that's because I know some people here are very familiar with the issues that we'll talk about today, but I want to make sure that everybody who took their time to come here tonight is able to get some basic idea of what a compressor station is. I think that's fundamental. If nothing else, if Spectra Energy is going to build this facility, in your community, people here have a right to know what are these facilities. And the next point is, once we talk about what a compressor station is, we'll talk about what pollution comes out of it. That is a known known. That's not at all controversial. The facility would release pollution, and a lot of our time tonight will be spent talking about what that pollution is. The last point, I think, is what a lot of people want to know. How might this facility affect our health? And that's a more challenging topic, clearly very important. And what I'll do is take a little bit of time and show a couple of examples based on data of how we can think about to what extent might this facility impact the community's health. And to start with, I want to make sure that we all understand what we mean when we talk about this compressor station, when we talk about the pipeline. The compressor station would be an add-on or expansion to the existing Algonquin pipeline. So for anybody who's lived in the area for any period of time might know that this pipeline has been around for decades. It was built around 1960. It runs from Pennsylvania, where the pipeline picks up gas that's produced by fracking or hydraulic fracturing. That gas and everything that comes out of the ground with it travels through the Algonquin pipeline system and up into New England through Connecticut and a little bit of Rhode Island, Massachusetts. And so this is a map from the Access Northeast project, which is what the Rehoboth compressor station is under. So the Spectra Energy is the company that owns Algonquin, which is not only the name of the pipeline, but it's the company that operates the pipeline. So I'll use both of those names tonight. But they also operate a lot of other facilities. So the all of these little boxes, if you look into the application, are the different facilities that are part of the Access Northeast project. And these four in particular, I think are worth pointing out because they're different facilities that are part of Access Northeast that you might have heard about. So one of those boxes is the Rehoboth compressor station. Another box is the Acushnet LNG liquefied natural gas facility. Another is that yellow box, and my pointer's not working as well. The middle yellow box is the Q1 loop that people in towns like Sharon and Walpole are upset about because that would be a brand new section of pipeline for their towns. And then in the upper right box, the green one, is the compressor station in Weymouth. But again, that compressor station has not been built yet. It's actually under a different project. So that's the big picture. The gas comes up from Pennsylvania. Spectra is the one who operates the pipeline like a toll road. They make money by shipping the gas up into New England. They deliver it to our homes, to companies. They sell it to companies like National Grid and Eversource, who then deliver it to our homes. They can send the gas to power plants or LNG facilities. And that's how they make money, is by transporting the gas. And in fact, the Rehoboth compressor station has been in the works for a while. Spectra Energy has been thinking about this for a long time because it was pretty easy for me to find. Going back as far as 2008, they were talking about putting a compressor station here. So that just gives you some sense that this is a very large company and they have a lot of resources and have been investigating this for a long time. And this is the site. I think my sense of talking to people here is that everyone here is quite familiar with this already. These brownish red lines are the existing Algonquin pipeline. Again, that was built decades ago, but in order to increase the amount of gas they transmit through the pipeline, they have to put in a compressor station, which we'll talk more about. So the blue box would be the actual station, which is like a small complex. And then the blue lines are a couple of connections to the pipeline, and then the other lines just point out some of the property that they own already or property that they need to acquire, at least as of the time of when this was released. It sounds like they might have already started acquiring property. Okay, so now we can talk, after getting kind of a big picture of the Algonquin pipeline and the fact that what's it doing and why is it running into New England, we can talk about compressor stations specifically. So this is a compressor engine. And it's an engine and a turbine. This is, when we talk about a compressor station, this is the main facility. This is a Solar Torus compressor engine. This is pretty similar to what would come into Rehoboth. So they want to put in a Solar Torus 70. I just don't know the number of this one, but it's a Solar Torus. And the technology actually, it's kind of hard to tell from this picture, but it's something called a centrifugal compressor. And the technology is quite similar to the technology of an airplane jet engine or a compressor from a power plant, or this would even be used in the LNG facility in the Cushion. And so what happens is the engine burns the gas. It's sitting, remember, it would connect up to the pipeline, would burn the gas in order to power the turbine, which would then generate the compression in the pipeline. And so that really generates pressure. And the reason is that the pipelines operate under very high pressure, somewhere on the order of 750 pounds per square inch. So if you think about your car tires, that might be 30 pounds per square inch. One of these high pressure interstate pipelines operates at over 20 times that amount of pressure, which is part of why they're very hazardous when they explode. And in order to generate that pressure, the company needs to have compressor stations all along the pipeline route. So prior to Rehoboth, the next one up the pipeline system is in Burrillville, Rhode Island. And in order to, as part of this Access Northeast project, for them to get the gas out, more gas out to other parts of New England, again, for example, to an LNG facility, a power plant, selling more to towns, they need more compression power from a compressor station. And these are set up maybe on the order of every 40 to 100 miles along the pipeline route. So that's the inside view. This is an outside view. This is not on the East Coast, but one of the things I like about this picture is that it shows, gives you some sense of that's the building, and then there's a pipe yard outside of the building. So this is really, we're talking about a complex. This is not, you know, I think it's hard, if you haven't been investigating this, it's hard to understand that this is a large engine that's part of a complex. But this, there's something also important to notice from this picture. This is a compressor station in Pennsylvania. The main building is probably bigger than what would go into Rehoboth if it were approved. But what's important to point out is that to the left of that building are a bunch of tanks. And that's an important point that's often left out of the discussion, because the compressor engine itself is this big facility. It's the thing that's making the bulk of the pollution. But there are a lot of other things at compressor stations that might also be very important for human health. And then the other thing I like about this picture is there's a house at the bottom. So you can kind of get a sense of, like, you know, how, what scale this is compared to someone's house. So like I've been saying, a compressor station is a complex. And this is a typical setup for what you might find at a compressor station. There's the engine and the turbine. So we saw the picture of that in the main building. And then there are a couple of other things, dehydrators, separators. And what those are pieces of equipment that process the gas. And you might ask, why do you have to process the gas? So what they actually have to do is remove a lot of the impurities from the gas before it gets burned in the compressor engine. There's actually a lot of nasty stuff in the gas, as we'll see. And if all of that went into the compressor engine and were burned in the engine, it would actually shorten the lifespan of the compressor engine. It could damage the compressor engine. So the gas coming through the pipeline has to be processed, and a lot of that nasty stuff pulled out. And that's the job of the dehydrator and the separator. Now the thing is, once you pull out that nasty stuff, you're concentrating it and putting it in the storage tank. And that's this condensate storage tank. And we'll talk more about that as well. And then there are gas heaters, coolers, backup generator, all of those can generate noise and pollution, and the pipe yard. We talked about that. So at this point, hopefully we have some sense that, you know, this compressor station is a complex with a lot of stuff in it. And one of the different ways that it might generate pollution. Now we can talk about what's going to come out of it. So the different ways that the station can generate pollution is by burning the gas in the compressor. And again, for certain kinds of pollution, that's where the majority of the pollution is going to come from. Very important. But I think, you know, that's kind of the, of course, you know, the, everybody expects, if you learn about the facility, you know, of course that's where a lot of the pollution will come from. But the other thing is, these are again, high-pressure pipelines, and if the pipeline pressure gets too high, there's the risk of a pipeline rupture. If the pipeline needs to be maintained, if there's an emergency, the gas needs to be vented out. And what that means is simply that a compressor station is one point on the pipeline where the gas can just be released directly into the air. For example, if they need to release excess pressure, it's just going to vent right into the air. And what did I just say on the last slide? There's nasty stuff in the gas. That just gets released directly into the air around the compressor station. So we'll talk in detail about all of those things. It's also a high-pressure system. That means that it's going to be leaking. This is a very well-studied problem with the natural gas pipeline system in the United States. There's a lot of research being done. There are a lot of regulations at the federal level about this. And that's because we're trying to figure out how much methane is actually leaking out of these natural gas pipeline systems. And it's because at 750 pounds per square inch, it's hard to create a pipe junction that's not going to leak under that amount of pressure. So these applications, they also do calculations to say, here's how much gas is going to leak out of all of the joints in the pipeline system, et cetera, et cetera. And then those storage tanks that I talked about, they are generally, like for example, the ones that I learned about on the Spectres pipeline system, store this toxic material at atmospheric pressure. But because of the nature of the way tanks work, sometimes they have to vent off a little bit of the gas. When the material is transported from the high pressure to the low pressure system, there's a lot of vaporization of chemicals. So that's another source of pollution. And of course, a whole separate category is noise pollution. So at this point, I really just kind of touched the surface. A little bit about what a compressor station is, how they work, and how they generate pollution. But in my experience in the past year, what I found is that communities like Rehoboth really have had very few people come in and explain this. There are some people in the community who've learned a lot about facilities, just like I have. And I wasn't at the first informational meeting, but I wouldn't be surprised if this is the first time people might be hearing about this, and that's why I really wanted to make sure we understand the nature of these facilities. And now we can move on to a much heavier topic, what pollution comes out of these stations. And now we're going back to the known knowns, known unknowns kind of analogy. So these are the things that are definitely coming out. Noise, nitrogen oxides, particulate matter, carbon monoxide, all organic compounds, which include formaldehyde, benzene, radon. The reason why I say these are known knowns is because, as we'll see, this is from, I got this from documentation from the company themselves and from the federal agencies that review these projects. So this, if, for example, they're coming, Spectra Energy is coming to town next week to talk, I'm not sure if they're going to touch on air pollution or if they've come to town before and talked about it. This is not even questionable. All of the data I'll show you about this are from the company themselves. Things that are likely and or possible: mercury, radioactive lead, chromium, PCBs. And there is a whole other category of air pollution which doesn't even get directly addressed in these applications, which is that when some of these things are released into the atmosphere, they undergo reactions. And that's how ozone gets formed a lot of the time, is that things react in the atmosphere and forms ozone, which is one of the six main air pollutants regulated by the EPA. And particulate matter is also formed, it's released directly, but there's also secondary formation of particulate matter. And I'm not even saying more about that myself, but it's a completely under-evaluated topic. So this is one of the really important points that I wanted to make tonight, is what is the pollution that comes out? And a lot of these names, we're going to talk about them, I'll spend some time explaining them. But this is, to me, so fundamental that people here in Rehoboth understand, number one, what is the facility, number two, what comes out of it. I want to go through it a second time, in a way that hopefully, after hearing it two times, will help it kind of stick in our minds. So again, this is a picture of the compressor engine. And out of that, one completely distinct category of pollution, noise pollution, very important. Second category, air pollution. And out of the air pollution, we can also categorize those things by whether they're released from burning gas, or whether they come out from just releasing gas directly into the air, or whether those things come out regardless of whether it's vented or the gas is burned, etc. So things that come from burning are nitrogen oxides, particulate matter, carbon monoxide, organic compounds, as just carbons. Things that are released, methane. Methane is indirectly important for human health. It's quite flammable if the pipeline were to explode or the cessation explode. But also is a potent driver of climate change, and so that's also going to affect human health. But of course, the VOCs, those organic compounds, and the hazardous pollutants, those are actually in the gas itself and just released directly in the air when there's venting. And things that don't get modified by burning, radon, lead, mercury, and perhaps chromium, whether the gas is, if you burn lead, what do you have with lead? If you burn radon, what do you have with radon? And so whether the gas comes, whether that's coming out of the exhaust from the compressor engine, or it's directly from venting the gas, that stuff is coming out. And you might be wondering, lead, well, lead is in my paint, lead, we used to put lead in gasoline, what is lead doing in a gas pipeline, right? And the reason is that all of those things, radon, lead, mercury, chromium, can all exist as, radon is only a gas, but the other things can exist as a gas or a solid. And so it is possible, if not likely, that those things were highly likely, that those things are moving through the pipeline already, right now, as a gas. And another point to make about these things, all of that first category, everything I listed there, is either toxic and or cancer causing. The second category, the things that are released directly into the air, every one of them, except methane, toxic and or cancer causing. And what about the last category? Toxic and or cancer causing. If there is a spectra energy representative here tonight, I would like to thank you for coming. If it were possible to publicly acknowledge that with them, I would like to do so, because in my experience, they downplay this completely. Again, I will show you their data showing that these things come out of compressor stations, and it's well known these things are toxic and cancer-causing. We're going to talk about, we're going to show a lot of numbers and tables and charts and whatnot, so if nothing else, if you are overwhelmed, if you are exhausted mentally from looking at numbers, this is really, I think, one of the most important things to remember tonight. Don't let anybody tell you this does not release pollution, and that the pollution, if it does come out, is harmless. Noise. I only have a couple things to say about noise. In my experience, talking to people who live near compressor stations, these are some of the things they say. It'll vent at night, which is kind of a loud, disruptive process. And sometimes when they vent or do other things, they produce vibrations. So maybe it's rattling the dishes in the cupboards. It sounds like a jet engine. There was one emergency event that went several hours, and miles away, people said it sounded like a loud jet engine. It was extremely disruptive for the community. They didn't know what was going on. But this, I try not to show too much text in my slides, but this, I felt, when it comes to noise, this is going to tell us a lot more than what I could say. This is testimony that a Rhode Island resident submitted. This person lives near a compressor station in Rhode Island. She submitted this testimony to explain how her life is affected by noise, because there may be a power plant going up right next to the compressor station, which is right by her house. The noise and vibration emanating from the Rhodeville facility, which is the compressor station, is extremely disruptive to my husband and me, negatively impacted her ability to sleep and to her property and her health. My husband is 100% disabled. His health and survival was at rest. He relies on him getting good quality sleep. The continued noise and vibration and disrupted sleep pattern and stress level has reached a point his cardiologist told us not to get stressed. Hard to do that when you're facing the noise and vibration on a daily basis. Occurs almost daily, ranges from a constant drone, like a diesel truck, to a loud jet plane running. Sounds like jet planes take off. And again, remember I said the technology, this is actually quite similar to jet engines. In fact, General Electric makes compressor station engines, they make jet engines, they make power plant engines that all have the same technology. So there's a lot of credibility to this analogy of a jet engine. Last several minutes, the noise cycles between a diesel truck to a jet plane taking off can last for hours. reason why I'm not going to say more about noise beyond explaining or sharing with you what it's like to live near one of these facilities is that the noise analysis for the Rehoboth compressor station, just like the details of the air pollution analysis, won't be out until the full pre-filing resource report business comes out. So we actually don't have the information about this right now. But I want to point out, just a word of warning, the data in all of these applications are prepared by the company's consultants. So Spectra Energy goes out and hires their own consultants to do the noise surveys, which they may use from 2007 or earlier, since they've been looking at it for a long time. In Weymouth, they did the noise recordings at times that would look favorable for their noise analyses with respect to rush hour traffic and background noise levels. And the same companies that work for Spectra Energy also work for the federal agency that oversees the approval of these pipelines. So, and at the same time, this happens at the same time, the company, one consultant, will be providing guidance to the federal agency that is, at the same time, they're working for the company whose project is supposed to be helping to review. It's a blatant conflict of interest, which has not been addressed. Fortunately, we in Massachusetts, we have state noise regulations. The compressor station will have to meet those. And the regulations apply before and after construction. If you want to learn more about this conflict of interest issue, Senator Markey and Warren have both submitted letters to the federal agency about this. And there's a journalist and a professor who's done a lot of work on it. If you were to write down his name and search him, he does post a lot on Twitter, or you do an internet search of his name with the small blog, and you can find a lot of information about the company and how they operate. So, going back to air pollution now, I want to, at least for a few of the pollutants, want to talk about what they are so we have a little more of a concrete idea. VOCs, volatile organic compounds, just means they're airborne. Organic is a chemistry term, it just means they're carbon-based and they're compounds, so there's molecules. It's easier to understand the examples. Methane, ethane, methanol, ethanol, naphthalene, benzene, formaldehyde, these are all examples of VOCs. Some of them come out of compressor stations, the ones in mold, ethane as well. And some of them are not toxic for humans, like ethane. Ethanol and methanol are toxic for humans, although we overlooked that in the case of ethanol. But there are other things to get back to this idea of known unknowns. There's a volatile organic compound that's released by some compressor stations, trans-4-methyl-2-pentene. I tried finding information in the health literature about this compound, and there's very little that's understood about it. Some compressor stations release it. What's it doing? I have no idea. Nitrogen dioxide, you might think, well, nitrogen, our atmosphere is mostly nitrogen, but that's dinitrogen, and two, nitrogen oxide, or dioxide, is a nitrogen with two oxygens. And when it's two nitrogen atoms together, it's extremely stable. When it's with two oxygen atoms, it's quite reactive. And because of that reactivity, it's toxic for human health. And so it's toxic, and in fact, if you combine nitrogen dioxide with VOCs, that can produce ozone and smog. Another pollutant that is commonly released by, well, it's released by all compressor stations is fine particulate matter. And particulate matter is released by burning anything, really, whether it's coal, oil, gas. And what it is simply microscopic particles. That's the easiest way to think about it. If you compare this grain of sand to a human hair, those red dots on the human hair would be the coarse particles, and within each of those would be fit many small, fine particles. And those two things, fine particles, coarse particles, and the nitrogen dioxide I just talked about, are three of the six major air pollutants regulated by the EPA, particularly, especially because they're so toxic. That's why they're regulated by the EPA. And what makes particulate matter toxic is that they're composed of these organic compounds, which can be harmful to human health, heavy metals, ions, and because they're so small, they actually don't get caught in your nose hairs, even your upper airway. They're so small, they get down deep into your lungs, and they get down to the point where your bloodstream is in close communication to the air where you're exchanging oxygen and carbon dioxide. And because of that, it makes it easier for those particles to get into your bloodstream and deliver anything in there that's toxic into the body. And it's certainly, particularly batteries, is quite toxic for human health. So the reason I went through those few slides is just to make sure that, you know, I didn't leave things like nitrogen dioxide as a complete black box mystery. But what I want to do now is go into some of the data that I've gotten from the company's own documents to show not only that these pollutants would come out of a compressor station, but have some idea of how much. And the thing is, like the noise analysis, I said that the noise data aren't going to come out until their full application comes out. Same thing with the air pollution. So what we can do instead is we can look back at the project that precedes the Access Northeast, which is the Atlantic Bridge, that if you've heard of the Weymouth Compressor Station, and that pollution analysis has been done. So we have a lot of details from the company about what comes out of their compressor stations. So if we compare, make a little table and compare these two, the compressor station that Spectra would like to build in Weymouth, and this is under review right now, it's not approved, would be a Taurus 60, 7,700 horsepower. They did the pollution analysis, it's released. Rehoboth would be a Taurus 70, but you can see from the horsepower, you don't go up from 60 to 70, you don't add another 10 units of horsepower. You actually add a significant amount of horsepower, almost 11,000. And the pollution analyses are pending. So what I'll show you in these next tables are Spectra's reports on how much pollution could come from a compressor station in Weymouth. Keep in mind, because the station in Rehoboth will be bigger, air pollution from the station here will likely be equal to or greater than what's coming out of the Weymouth station that I'll show you here. And they're very consistent in their applications. I think they'll do the same, from what I've seen, they'll probably do the same analysis, so I'm quite confident in making that statement. So this is table number one. This is like an overview of those major pollutants, not getting into the detailed pollutants. It lists for the Weymouth compressor station what all of the different parts of the station would produce what amounts of different pollutants, and then they list them on the left and they sum them up on the right. And it's a little hard to read, so I trim out the middle and blow it up a little bit, so the pollutant. Right. Again, oh, thank you. If the question comes up, you're talking to your neighbors, talking to your friends, you say, well, what is this station? You know, and is it really going to be that bad? Is it going to really release pollution? Yes. Because again, I put the reference here from last October. You have to go down to page 602 to find this information. So it's not hard to imagine how these things go through without anybody getting the details, because you have to get to page 602 of report 9, the 9th report. But on the left, it just shows, yep, we're going to release nitrogen oxides, carbon monoxide, right? We all know that's, we have those detectors at home because it can be fatal. It's toxic even at lower concentrations. All organic compounds, particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, and then hazardous materials. So this is not me saying that they're going to, the station will release pollution. This is the company. I'll take the question, and then if after that we can try to get to the end.
What's the unit of measure?
Right.
10.7. What is the unit of measure?
Right. The unit is a TPY, which is a ton per year.
Ton per year. Okay.
Yep, that's right. And why? So that's like the, when you look at these analyses, that's the introductory table. That's the big picture table. And why is it? And it's because a lot of those things I said are regulated by the EPA as part of their six major criteria pollutants, because they're so harmful to human health. And I just, you know, they're very well studied, things like particulate matter, nitrogen dioxide. We know a lot about them. And I just want to put up a few references here, just to give you some flavor of the fact that these are not good for you. Again, this is like, I have a much more extensive list than this, but this is just a sample. Nitrogen dioxide, increased hospitalizations for respiratory illness and heart failure, carbon monoxide, affects premature birth rates and low birth weight, particulate matter fatality from heart and lung disease, childhood asthma, new cases of childhood asthma. This would go, there are thousands. of studies on why these pollutants are bad for your health. So I don't want you to think I just picked out the only ones out there. This will go on and on, but we'll stop it there. So now, that main table, a lot of the pollutants in that main table come from burning gas. So this is a more detailed table. Clearly, this is extremely confusing. But the reason I put it up is this is called a flash analysis. So if you look at the, again, in the details, page 744, they have to do an analysis of the stuff that would come out of these storage tanks on the property. And the worst time for that those tanks to release pollution is this flashing, which is when the pollution that they're pulling, the garbage they're pulling out of the gas at high pressure, then they put it into a low pressure or atmospheric pressure tank. And that, because the vapor pressure changes so much, it's just physics, a lot of stuff vaporizes at that time. And so, the column on the left, that red box shows you some of the names. Not for me, from the company. Benzene, ethylbenzene, hexane, toluene, xylenes. Benzene, no, you might have heard of that. It's not good for you. It causes cancer, it's toxic, it causes leukemia, it suppresses the bone marrow, it causes anemia, it causes headaches. So these things are important, and that's why their HAP is hazardous air pollutant. So all the way to the box on the red, these are all their calculations. The box on the right, sorry, the maximum rate they say is, these things could come out at a rate of up to 325 pounds an hour. So if that process were not for an hour, it would be 325 pounds of this stuff. I don't think that would be the case. There's in the middle, they say, over the course of a year, it would be 1.2 tons of these hazardous air pollutants. And again, if you think back to that main slide, remember this slide, because these things are toxic and cancer-causing. This is where that comes from. We're getting down into the details here. Benzene, I know very well. These other things can also be toxic and cancer-causing. So, it's probably not the flashing, this is probably not a continuous thing, but periodically probably releases a burst of this pollution. This gets no discussion anywhere. Right? This is completely overlooked. This is just how it is. Right? Except for when we get together and talk about it ourselves, when we think about it. Okay, I also made a point of saying that there's stuff, I've been repeating over and over, there's stuff in the gas. There's bad stuff in the gas. How do we know that? One way we know is because of tables like the one I just showed. They do those similar kinds of analyses for things like benzene. You know, when we vent the gas, we're going to release X amount of benzene, but it's not that much, so it's okay. Not a problem. But there's another piece of evidence I found recently, which is a report about a facility in New Bedford. So one branch of the Algonquin pipeline goes down to New Bedford, and at the end of that branch is a metering and regulating station. And that's where the Algonquin system stops, and they transition over to the local system run by National Grid or Source or any other local company. But in the process of operating that facility, they generate hazardous waste. Shouldn't be surprising since I'm telling you about the nasty stuff in the gas. And fortunately, there's a federal act which requires tracking of this hazardous waste, the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act. So there are reports, and I found one for the metering regulating station in Bedford. So it's Algonquin Gas, which is owned by Spectra Energy, 2007, and the fine print might be hard to read. It says New Bedford, Massachusetts, and this one here, if you look at the waste description, waste pipeline liquids with greater than 50 parts per million PCBs. And where did PCBs come from? Remember I said this pipeline is old. It was built before PCBs were outlawed in this country. So at the time, they were in a lot of industrial products. So when the pipeline was welded, I'm assuming that's where the PCBs came in when it was built. PCBs are also found at older compressor stations, so I'm not entirely sure what's the problem with the wiring or other things that led to PCBs being in the pipeline. But the pipeline itself right now has PCBs in it, and that's coming out at New Bedford and other places. And then if we look at this other box, red one in the middle of the screen, waste cones for generating waste. Ignitable waste, probably stuff like the benzene or polyorganic compounds. Barium, it's an element which can be toxic. It comes from fracking. Right? So there's a lot of barium, just like radon and radium. There's a lot of this in Pennsylvania, in the Marcellus Shale, where the gas comes from. It made its way into the pipeline all the way up to New Bedford. That's the whole pipeline system. Right? So that tells me something like barium exists as a gas all the way through, and it made its way to New Bedford. Next in the list is chromium, lead, and mercury. The lead could be there for, I can only think of one reason, which is that lead is a breakdown product of radon. So radon is, I think most people, if you're a homeowner in New England, you're probably familiar with radon. It's a radioactive gas. After cigarette smoking is the leading cause of lung cancer in this country. It's in the bedrock, it can seep into your basement, and so a lot of homes here have these radon mitigation systems that circulate the air to get the radon out of your basement. There's a lot of it in Pennsylvania where the gas is fracked. And just like the barium and a lot of other stuff, that goes into the gas. This is showing us right here. It came from New Bedford, or all the way up to New Bedford. Radon travels that distance as well. But radon has a relatively short half-life on the order of days. But what's the breakdown into? The federal agencies talk about radon, and it's not a real health risk. But it breaks down into some things that are not radioactive, but some things it does break down into are radioactive, including radioactive lead, which has been found associated with pipelines in Pennsylvania. To my, the best of my knowledge, that testing has not been done in Massachusetts. And there's no discussion of how to test for radiation, how to control radiation associated with pipelines when these applications go through. The company, the consultant who works for the federal agency and the company just says in their environmental assessment, well, there's some radon there, but the reports that have been done or the analysis that have been done show that it's not a problem. What about the lead? Because radioactive lead is radioactive for upwards of 20 years. And now there's lead in this hazardous waste from New Bedford. And there's the reference. I'm sorry, it's a long address, if you were to find one. Now, mercury, lead, chromium, we're here to talk about health risks. I really think from a logical point of view, these things are in the gas. A lot of them have traveled all the way to New Bedford, which is towards the end of the Algonquin pipeline system. It starts in Pennsylvania and comes up here. So I just want to take a moment and just review the basic, some basic information about how these things affect our health. Lead, toxic to children, right? That's why we have to get it out of paint, chewed from children's toys, et cetera, et cetera. Can lead, and this is all from the EPA, very basic stuff. Behavior and learning problems, lower IQ, hyperactivity, slow growth, hearing problems, anemia, mercury, right? A lot of it in the environment came from burning coal that then settled out in the rain into our lakes and fish, and we eat the fish and we burn it. A lot of neurologic problems, including headaches, weakness, nerve function changes. Chromium, I may not know as much about, it's used, produced, and released in certain industries. And this is unknown, because I have no idea how the chromium is getting into the gas. It's potentially also coming from Pennsylvania. Chromium, if you breathe it, shortness of breath, coughing, wheezing, if you ingest it, abdominal pain, vomiting, diarrhea, hemorrhage, may result in complications during pregnancy and childbirth if you breathe it. And it is classified as a human carcinogen if you inhale it, increased risk of lung cancer. All right, so just there's that one little slide I showed, but it's not trivial. I think this is, I literally found this 3 weeks ago, and I'm still trying to process what this means and trying to pursue this, but I think it's very important for us to understand. And again, if you go back to those slides about where does the pollution come, how does a station make pollution? To the extent that this stuff is in the gas, right, and remember lead, mercury, these things come out, it's just as a gas, even though it might seem funny. If it's vented into the air, mercury, lead, maybe radioactive lead, chromium, that's going to be vented into the air. If it's burned, that mercury is going to be released into the air, the lead, the chromium, it's not going to be dissolved, dissipated into nothing once it's burned in the compressor station. So again, just to reiterate my thinking on this, gas flowing through Rehoboth reaches New Bedford, right? The pipeline passes through here, right now, on its way to New Bedford. The gas was processed there. And when it was processed, what came out was hazardous waste with lead, mercury, and chromium. These things are very important for human health, but I have to tell you, I have never once heard about chromium in the gas. I talked about lead at the submitted comments to federal agencies about lead because I said a radar could break down into lead, and has anyone considered this? And then I found this report, someone brought to my attention, a report from Pennsylvania showing that yes, they found high levels of radioactive lead associated with some of their pipelines. That goes nowhere. And mercury. The LNG facility in Acushnet would have equipment specifically designed to remove mercury from the gas, because that equipment is extremely sensitive and they can't have any mercury left in the gas. Right? This is, again, that's in their filing for the LNG facility right now. So why would we put equipment to remove mercury from the gas if it's not there? It's there. Another thing is, if you look at the web pages for companies that provide supportive, that support the operation of pipelines, they'll do a lot of advanced testing of the gas. One of the things they're very proud of, oh, we can test for the mercury in your gas and tell you how much mercury is in your gas, right? So there's a lot of evidence to support the fact that the gas already going through the pipeline has got toxic metals in it. And this is not addressed at all. These things are simply not addressed when these applications go through the system. And I bring these points up sometimes, other people bring them up, and it's rare that they're actually addressed by anyone. Alright, so that's an unknown unknown. To what extent is that mercury, lead, etc. a problem? We don't know. Nobody is looking at it. Alright, a couple more things. When you burn the gas, it produces hazardous air pollutants. The one that's most prevalent, produced in the greatest quantity, is formaldehyde. And that's because formaldehyde is produced by burning a lot of things, but it turns out that methane, in the process of burning from methane all the way to carbon dioxide, it goes through a series of chemical reactions. And one of those, it forms formaldehyde, and a lot of that gets, you know, exits the chemical combustion reaction. Carbon monoxide is the same thing. So I think that's like, makes a lot of sense, right? Carbon monoxide, when you burn stuff, you've got a pilot light at home, you could end up with carbon monoxide poisoning because it's a byproduct of burning anything. There's a lot of other stuff I won't get into, but formaldehyde we'll come back to. Again, this is for the Weymouth compressor station to release 1,500 pounds a year. It would produce that much, but there would be a pollution control that only 790 pounds would come out in the course of the year. You know, kind of going back to your point, what's the unit of measure? Tons per year, what does that mean? Tons per year, pounds per year, those are regulatory numbers. They don't tell us anything about human health. So one of the ways I like to make some sense of it is to compare that formaldehyde number to a gas fueled power plant. And the comparison I use is this one that would be in Bergen, Rhode Island. It's not clear if that'll be built. A 1,000 megawatt gas power plant. It would produce or release 1,450 pounds a year. The height, 200 feet. All right. Weymouth, which again, similar but smaller to the Rehoboth compressor station. 790 pounds a year, but yeah, we're good. Half as much as a power plant. But it would only be, it would be released at a third of the height, right? 60 feet. It would be much closer to the ground. Half as much, three times as low to the ground. And we're talking about a massive 1,000 megawatt power plant, right? A compressor station would release, you know, depending on how you factor in the distances and that kind of thing, half as much to about as much formaldehyde on the ground level, comparing a compressor station to a power plant. You know, and if you look at the engine in a compressor station, it's probably on the order of a small power plant. They have megawatt ratings. I mean, they usually in horsepower, but you can also convert that to megawatt ratings, which is probably on like a under 20 megawatts. But still, at least a lot of people behind it. Okay, so let's take a moment and recollect. We talked about the compressor station, what's in this complex. Talked about what comes out of the compressor station. And remember, I said these are the two points I really wanted to make sure that we got to today, because everybody here deserves to know what a compressor station is. Everybody deserves to know what could come out of them. And I tried to back up my list of what comes out of the compressor station with tables of the company's own documents. These are not studies that I've done, or unpublished or unverified observations. These are the company's own observations. So whether either before this or at this point, you know, you might be asking, well, what is the, how is this going to affect our health? So I want to use just a couple of examples to go through how we might think about it. I don't think we're at a point where we can actually make strong claims and say, well, there are going to be X more number of cases, like 5 more people are going to get asthma, 2 more people are going to die each year because of this facility. We simply do not have strong enough data to really answer that question. And the reason I bring it up now is because a lot of people, when we get to this point of the conversation, a lot of people feel, well, you know, it's great you talked about, you showed some numbers and rates and percentages and that kind of thing, and that's nice, but that doesn't really have an impact. What we really know is, you know, how many people are going to get a heart attack or a stroke from this pollution, from this thing? And I really cannot tell you that I myself do not have the data and the analyses to make those conclusions. But we can still talk about a lot. There's a lot to talk about. So if we're going to think about the health risks, there's, for starters, there's a few different kinds of data that we can use. One of the hardest to understand, because it's not at all intuitive, is public health data, public health research. So there are simply no public health studies on compressor stations. The bottom line is that would be the strongest evidence we have none. You would do that study by looking at hospital records or clinic records, and you say, well, if let's look at 100 people near the station and 100 people away from the station, like a compressor station, a power plant, anything. And you say, well, do the people who live near this thing, like live near a power plant, have more asthma than people who live away from it? Right? That's kind of the rationale of a public health study. Very powerful, very well respected in the scientific community. What we do have, I'll show you one set of results from the health survey data. Not as powerful, but important to show. And what we really have to spend, you know, the most exhausting part of the night talking about are pollution. We've already been talking about pollution. We're going to talk about the concentration of pollution near compressor stations. And from that, from what we know about pollution, we'll try to make some sense of, get some feeling for, you know, are there real health risks or not that we care about. Okay, so this group here, Southwest Pennsylvania Environment Health Project, they work in Pennsylvania, and they've done a little work in New York. They surveyed people who live within a mile of a new compressor station. And what they found is, within a mile, people who live near the station have, it seems like, a lot of health symptoms that they complain about. Respiratory symptoms, nosebleeds, headaches, and rashes. And those symptoms are all things we would expect based on what we know about the pollution. So this is one, you know, for, if this makes sense for you to think about it this way, this is one type of study that's being done. And they're doing a lot more work in New York related to this. So what I'm going to talk about is the less intuitive and more challenging topic of, you know, if we know the concentration, you know, we talked about the tons, but if we know the concentration of nitrogen oxides or particulate matter, then we can talk about health impacts. As we can start that. So we have to talk about how you get from a ton per year to a concentration, right? So the company is going to add up and say, well, in 1 year, we'll release a ton. But what happens is that ton is coming out of a smokestack. It's being produced at a variable rate. The weather is changing. It's very complicated. So what we, you know, what makes the most sense is to look at the station here and then ask, you know, where's the boundary of the safe zone? Danger zone. And that's, I will use this circle in another slide, but it's actually a very hard question to answer, very challenging. And the reason is that in real life, we might want things to be straightforward, but they're actually very complicated. So, again, the things that affect how air pollution spreads. comes out is how much is being produced and how quickly. The properties of the smokestack are very important, and the weather is extremely important. So on a calm day, pollution might spread up from a smokestack and just sit there. Some of it will, depending on the properties of the pollution, will just get spread out into wherever, and some will settle back down in the community. If the wind is moving through the area, like a strong wind moving through, just a straight wind blowing through where the pollution is produced, it'll blow it in a direction, a specific direction. So you can see there's a little house at the bottom of that black cloud of smoke. And, you know, if you can see the house, if you were standing there, like looking at it, thinking like, well, it looks terrible, but right now it looks okay. And your livestock in the foreground are okay, because you're watching it blow away. Same thing with that other smokestack in the bottom right. If you live to the left of it, you're getting the brunt of it. And if you live to the right, you're feeling pretty good. Until the seasons change, and the prevailing winds change direction, and it blows all that stuff right at you. So those are a couple of atmospheric conditions, but there's another one, which is that the atmosphere at ground level can just be turbulent. And that just mixes things up. And so all of those things will do different things to the concentration of pollution. And I think on some level, if you think about smoke, it makes sense, right? Like somebody's burning something, or they're at a campfire, the wind blows a certain way, and then you get more or less of the stuff. It's blowing around. So one of the two examples I want to talk about today is going back to the example of formaldehyde that's produced by burning the gas. It's toxic, and this sign is not correct. It's formally classified as a carcinogen. And from these federal agencies, we know from all of their work that at concentrations as low as 0.08 micrograms per cubic meter, it increases the risk of cancer. Toxic at 10 to 49 micrograms per cubic meter. Formaldehyde increases the risk of a couple of cancers that are not common to begin with. Nose throat cancer, specific nose throat cancer, and a specific form of leukemia. And it causes these symptoms. It's irritating for the nose and the eyes, it can cause headaches, but it also sensitizes you, so it's going to make it more likely for you to develop allergic conditions like asthma, environmental allergies, and eczema. And it also affects lung function. So this is, you know, this is why concentrations are important, because when we study pollution, we study what's the concentration that a person is exposed to. That's the most important thing for, you know, studying toxic effects and cancer. It's, you know, the grams you eat per day are not as important as the concentration you're exposed to usually. So we can use that as a starting point, and then we can use those numbers to make some sense of data that were obtained by a group studying compressor stations. So what they did is they took air samples near compressor stations in Pennsylvania. I present these data every time I speak because when you want to understand compressor stations, it's very important. And most of these samples were looking at formaldehyde. This is what I consider the worst case scenario out of the data in this study from Pennsylvania. 790 meters is about half a mile from a facility, this 6,200 horsepower compressor station, 61 micrograms per cubic meter. Right? This is like a microgram, it's a milligram, and a cubic meter is a big area of space. You know, and 0.08 micrograms is like 80 nanograms. It's very small amounts in a large amount of air. So now, this is one of the ways we can try and get some sense of health risks, is put all of that together. Now we go back to our map. This red circle represents about half a mile from the station. So I do apologize to anyone living on the roads near the circle, because what I have to say I find distressing. Certainly would be if I lived near the red circle. So now we go back to, in that one study, what do people measure? At that red circle, that's the distance where they measured at 61 micrograms per cubic meters. Now we can go back to the concentration. We can go back to our studied concentrations, increasing cancer risk at 0.08 micrograms per cubic meter, and toxic at 10 to 49 micrograms per cubic meter. So in other words, if you do the math, 61 ends up at 762 times 0.08. So, if you were to breathe that concentration of formaldehyde over a prolonged period of time, your risk of those cancers would go up by a factor of 762. On a shorter time frame, it would still be toxic on the order of hours to a day, but only it would only increase your risk of having those symptoms by 1.25 to 6 times. To some extent, that's a little bit of a numbers game, because what I've told you is, if you put that information together, the outcome is a 762 increased risk of cancer. Another way of talking about these kind of data is to say, what is the cancer, the absolute cancer risk? So you might say, well, the cancer risk is 1 in 10,000 people would get cancer by breathing that much formaldehyde. It would be 1 million divided by 762. I apologize, I don't have that number off yet. But it's on the order of 1 million divided by 1,000. That would seem to be not more than 1,000, 10,000. If somebody can help me.
1,000.
What's that?
1,000.
1,000. So, right, so then you say, well, 1 of 1,000 people would develop cancer. And one point I want to bring out, other than the fact that I'm going to modify the slide, is there are other studies of compressor stations where they say, well, we looked at other things, formaldehyde and other chemicals, and the risk of cancer was only 1 out of every 200,000 people, 1 out of 100,000 people, whatever the number is. And I leave it to you, if you live within that red circle, along the edge of the red circle, right outside the red circle, the formaldehyde doesn't drop to zero right outside the red circle. Right? Think about the smoke, we saw that it spreads out. How do you feel? Does that, you feel better knowing it's only 1 in 100,000? No, the 1 in 1,000 sounds kind of bad. 1 in 100,000, no big deal. But that's actually kind of the cutoff that a lot of health analyses use to say, well, once you get to a 1 in 100,000, it's kind of like some background or unimportant level. They track it down to 1 in 1,000,000, but the 1 in 100,000, we call that, it's not a big deal. Anybody living there, I would say you have the right to make your own decision on that. As a pediatrician, I have my own perspective on what I find to be acceptable, which is zero. We could do the same thing with particulate matter. There's another report. This time, we're looking at a compressor station, one specific one in Pennsylvania. It's that, I apologize with the pointer, that red blob in the middle is a compressor station. In this case, this one reason why this study is important is because there's no other industrial source of particulate matter in that area. So the majority of it is going to be coming from the compressor station. So what the EPA did a couple years ago is they put a testing station for particulate matter near the compressor station. And then another agency analyzed the data that we'll look at here. And so the point of this is to say, well, if you were in that unique situation for that specific compressor station, we can try and pick up what is the amount of the change in that concentration that we think is caused by the pollution coming out of the station, right? Because I can go back to the company's documents and tell you the tons per year. But really what we need to know are the concentrations, and we'll see why. So there are two ways to measure particulate matter and a lot of pollutants. It's averaged over different periods of time. So for particulate matter, one average is a 24-hour average. So in the course of the day, what's that daily concentration? In the next slide, we'll see the annual average. So the regional monitor, like the about 20 miles away, this is like the federal standard. Over this monitoring testing period, the concentration, the highest 24-hour period, or peak, like the day with the highest concentration is 12.3. And what they found near the compressor station was 19. So if you look at the difference, 6.7, the only industrial source of this pollution was the compressor station. And that's the difference, 6.7. Now, this is another way of doing that health risk analysis, okay? Because we can go back to, remember I said, something like particulate matter, thousands upon thousands of studies. Harvard School of Public Health, they're doing research on this all the time. They're very active on this issue, and in fact, that first study is out of the Harvard School of Public Health. And we can say, well, what they do in all of their public health studies is they say, well, if we see a unit increase in the concentration, like it goes up by 10 micrograms, 5 micrograms, what's the change in the population health outcome that we see? And then we can say, well, you know, if it were to be 6.7, that, you know, if the pollution goes up by 6.7 because of the compressor station, based on just these couple of studies, which after reviewing them, I found to be two of the most applicable to the concentrations we're talking about, the circumstance we're talking about, 11% increased risk of stroke. So, you know, if you're within that vicinity, you know, if you're a person who may have a slightly increased risk of stroke, well, it could go up by 11% your risk of stroke. If you're a child who has a somewhat of a predisposition to develop asthma, after a day of where the particulate matter is that much higher, your risk of a child's risk of getting asthma goes up by about 7%. We'll do the same thing for the annual concentrations. This was a short-term study over a period of weeks. What the federal agency that published the report did is they looked at if this were to continue over the course of the year, so they kind of estimated that. The regional monitor, the annual concentration, the average was 10.8. And what they estimated was between 15 and 16. So again, if we look at, well, for one thing, if we look at the state health standards, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, has said, well, particulate matter, the annual average should never go above 12, which at the regional monitor was fine, but locally it seems like it might have gone above 12. And the World Health Organization said we shouldn't actually go above 10. So then if we look at health outcomes, I just want to point one out here, again, because this is an example. We could go on, we could talk, we could have an hour's discussion just about this. But this is just a sample of the kind of thinking we could do. Mortality. If there were that kind of difference in the annual average, then we might see that death, mortality from lung cancer go up by 3.8%, diabetes 6%, heart attack 2.7%, and non-accidental causes 1.1%. So this is the point where some people will say, that percentage is, you know, that doesn't click with our everyday experience. People don't think about percentages, think about, like, you know, how many people are going to get diagnosed with asthma? Like, are you saying 5 people? Are you saying there's going to be 5 kids every year diagnosed with asthma because of this station? And that's the thing where we are missing a lot of the information we need to make those, to reach those conclusions. And so I really, part of coming here tonight is to show you data, even though if we don't hear data, but the data back up our claims and our arguments, and anything I say, I want to back up my data. So this is about as far as we can go with this kind of analysis right now. So we talked about the station, what comes out of it, a couple of ways to think about the health risks with a couple of examples that, you know, those pollutants are very important when we talk about what comes out of a compressor station. I just want to breeze through the last few points and share with you, even though we've been sitting here for a long time listening to me go on and on and on about air pollution, there are actually a lot of other issues, and we heard about property values, Tracy referenced that, but there are a lot of other issues that go beyond health. I just want to point out, I'm going to talk about one of them is safety. You might look at this and think, it looks like a nuclear bomb test. It's not. That is an exploding compressor station. This was about a year ago in Minnesota. Natural gas compressor station explosion. The Trans-Canada St. Vincent compressor station. Some people, if you get into detailed discussions about these things, they might say, well, burning gas is good because if we use that for electricity instead of coal, it's a lot cleaner. On some points, I would agree, if you only look at the power station, the power plant, that there may be some benefits for things like nitrogen oxides. But is it clean? Are you okay with having this in your neighborhood? I mean, a power plant burning gas could produce a lot of these stuff I already talked about. And if you look at this total for a power plant proposal in Rhode Island, right next to a compressor station in Burrville, hundreds and hundreds of tons of toxic air pollution produced by burning gas. So it's not clean. Another thing people have said, I mean, that's maybe more so 10 years ago, when the fracking boom started, and there's a huge push to develop fracking, and This is going to be a clean technology. It's going to be a bridge. It's cleaner than coal. It's an environmentalist. You should get on board because it'll help us get away from coal and, you know, get away from climate change faster. But what we're learning about methane is it's actually a lot worse than carbon dioxide. And the way that our gas pipeline systems work, when you frack the gas, when you transport the gas, when you burn the gas, there's a lot of methane leaking out. So this is a professor from Cornell. He and other people have a lot of, if you look at the climate change impact that results from using coal or methane to make electricity. So that's the y-axis here is, you know, the climate change impact per unit of electricity. And the left is natural gas, and the blue is coal. The yellow part is the climate change impact from carbon dioxide. The red bar, part of the bar, is the climate change impact from methane. And that's again the methane that's released directly into the air. So if you consider the big picture, if anything, the fact that we're buying into gas so heavily now in England is actually worse for climate change. You would have been much better off to just put the brake on everything and hold the coal until we can get out of it ASAP with wind, solar, demand regulation, energy efficiency, etc. Those things are not really producing pollution the way that gas does. Gas is polluting. Alright, so a few conclusions. At this point, after over a year of investigating this topic, I myself have reached the conclusion compressor stations pose a risk to the health of the community. I don't think that's a known unknown. I think that is a known known. And what I hope to do tonight is show you my reasons for why I think that's the case. And those are the reasons, along with everything else we've talked about. All these pollutants and the illnesses they cause, cancer, respiratory cardiovascular disease, they affect birth outcomes, affect pregnancies. And a lot of the time, what we don't know is, you know, we don't have the analyses to tell us are things like the mercury a risk to our health. That is simply not being done, and that's why it's a risk. So it's here. The risk of associated with compressor stations to me is clear. The degree of the risk is unclear. That I agree with. Are we talking about something that's terrible? I don't think it's, I mean, it's certainly not like a coal plant, right? That's pretty obvious. This is not the same as putting a coal burning power plant in the hole. But is there no problem with it? No, there are problems with compressor stations. There is some risk to human health. And like I was alluding to with that slide on formaldehyde, you know, what's your personal acceptable risk of cancer? The 1 in 100,000, 1 in 1 million, 1 in 10,000, you know, what's acceptable to you? We can, I mean, federal and state agencies make their own decision about what they think is acceptable. We can make our own decision about what's acceptable. You will all make your own decision. What is the degree of health risk you find acceptable? Is there a small risk is acceptable, a large risk, no risk? The other thing I didn't point out, these stations are automated. Are we taking on all of this health risk for the short period of time that this thing is built? Because there won't be any union jobs operating this facility once it's built. So put that all together, think about all of the other issues, and ask ourselves, what do you think about this facility? Moving forward from here, if you want to continue learning more, I would recommend you can check in with your local organization, Citizens Against the Rehoboth Compressor Station. I'm part of an organization which is newly forming, Mass Healthcare Providers Against Frack Gas. We are slowly ramping up over a bit of a period of time, so we have a Facebook presence. You can see the things, the issues that we're looking at and interested in. We just started this WordPress site, and the reason why it's extremely preliminary. If you go there right now, you can find some of the documents we've prepared that include references to some of this material. I will be putting this presentation on that site, so you could check in now, later, future. And then if you want to see an example of a town that is not happy with having a compressor station come to their town, who have kind of all over me for the most part, that it's not something they want, you can check out this Forum of Residents Against the Compressor Station. It's one of several organizations in that area. Their website, I meant to put it up, is nocompressor.com. or if you search the name, you'll get to them too. It's also a good resource for learning more about the issues in general. It's very much focused on the compressor station proposal there. And also a good resource for statewide issues. Okay, so I really, again, thank you very much for listening. This was a lot of information. I've been doing talking for a very long time. Most people stayed here, and most people stayed awake. And I greatly appreciate that. And